Station.
This is us, all of us. So a child says, when I grow up, I want to be a hockey player. And the parent says, now, child, you know you can't do both. I always love that. The Killers, When You Were Young. With Nick Elliott and Kelly. And Nick, how about a thought on Team Europe USA?
Well, there's no doubt that they're going to come in and try to out-muscle everybody in this tournament. But they do have the highest finesse out of a centerman. And that is the highest scoring American in NHL history, winning that title, Pat Kane. John Tortorella admitted to me he's the one guy that gets more rope than anyone else to handle the puck. He can have it as long as he feels necessary. Everyone else better be on their best behavior when it comes to making decisions.
And I suspect, Nick, because all that firepower the U.S. has, that they'll get at least 15 shots. And for that reason, I say Halak is going to be the key for Team Europe.
It's interesting. I think Team Europe hoped that Frederik Andersen, who's going to play here in Toronto, would be their number one guy. But his injury opens it up for Halak to be their standard bearer.
A great celebration of excellence, the World Cup of Hockey. Jim Houston and Craig Simpson are in the broadcast booth. Scott Oak is ringside for all of us. Welcome to the ACC. It's game one of the tournament. Enjoy. Here's Jay Richardson.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the two teams competing in today's World Cup of Hockey game. Team USA and Team Europe. Today's lineup for Team USA. Number two, Matt Niskanen. Number three, Chad Johnson. Number four, John Carlson. Number six, Eric Johnson. Number eight, Joe Pavelski. Number 9, Zach Parise. Number 16, James Van Riemsdyk. Number 17, Ryan Kessler. Number 19, Brandon Dubinsky. Number 20, Ryan Suter. Number 21, Derek Stepan. Number 26, Blake Wheeler. Number 27, Ryan McDonough. Number 30, Ben Bishop. Number 32, Jonathan Quick. Number 42, David Backus. Number 67, Max Pacioretty. Number 74, TJ Oshie. Number 88, Patrick Kane. And number 89, Justin Abdelkader. The head coach for Team USA is John Tortorella. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the World Cup of Hockey 2016, Team USA. And now, here is today's lineup for Team Europe. Number 2, Andre Sequeira. Number 7, Mark Streit. Number 8, Tobias Rieder. Number 10, Christian Ehrhoff. Number 11, Andrei Kopitar. Number 12, Marion Gaborik. Number 21, Tomas Tatar. Number 22, Nino Niederreiter. Number 26, Thomas Vanek. Number 29, Leon Draisaitl. Number 31, Philip Grubauer. Number 33, Zdeno Chara. Number 36, Yannick Hansen. Number 41, Yaroslav Halak. Number 44, Dennis Seidenberg. Number 51, Franz Nielsen. Number 59, Roman Josi. Number 63, Matt Zuccarello. Number 78, Pierre-Edward Belmar. And number 81, Marian Hossa. The head coach for Team Europe is Ralf Krueger. Ladies and gentlemen, Team Europe. In celebration of the World Cup of Hockey and in the spirit of international competition, the teams will now exchange a commemorative banner. Would Team Europe captain Andrei Kopitar please join Team USA captain Joe Pavelski at center ice? And now, ladies and gentlemen, please stand if you're able to and remove your hats for the playing of the national anthem of Team USA.
After coming up short in both Vancouver and Sochi, the battle cry of Team USA in this World Cup is, it's time. Team Europe, meanwhile, hopes it's come together in time. A bit of a dramatic quote from head coach Ralph Kruger here today. We're ready to look into the eyes of America. Sounds like it could have come from the U.S. presidential election campaign. Nonetheless, we shall see if Europe can stare down America this afternoon in Game 1 of the 2016 World Cup. Jim Houston and Craig Simpson to describe the proceedings. Jim.
So this World Cup begins, Scott, with this eclectic mix of esoteric hockey no-mans called Team Europe up against a team that feels it can win now. Team USA, the goaltenders, USA are the visitors in this game, so they'll go with LA Kings netminder Jonathan Quick from Milford, Connecticut. The home team is from Europe, and they'll go with Yaroslav Halak, one of six Slovaks on this team. He beat out Thomas Greiss and Philip Grubauer. Ben Bishop, by the way, backs up goaltender Jonathan Quick. And there's Yaro Halak. And this first game of the World Cup is underway. The referees in the game are Kelly Sutherland and Gord Dwyer. And we should remind you that all of the rules in this tournament are NHL rules. Everything, including TV timeouts. So there'll be no confusion there and no incantations or deviations of international rules. Starting forward line for Team Europe. Anze Kopitar with Thomas Tatar and Marian Hossa. And as usual, when Anze Kopitar plays, he's got a checker, and it's Ryan Kessler. And they're used to chasing each other around the rinks of Southern California. Every time they play, they're matched up against each other. Kessler's line mates are Max Pacioretty of the Montreal Canadiens and TJ Oshie. And the Americans are into the attacking zone. Pacioretty couldn't get a shot on goal. The defensive pairs with O'Shara and Andrei Sekera. Both Slovaks. Matt Niskanen of the Washington Capitals is back with Ryan McDonough of the New York Rangers, who makes the play to center, and both teams will make changes on the fly. This should be the best defenseman in Team Europe. He's Nashville's Roman Josi, and he's stripped to the puck. Maple Leaf James Van Riemsdyk in with a shot, and it didn't get on goal. Dennis Seidenberg got his stick in there, and the puck was deflected away. Washington's John Carlson keeps the puck into the blue line. He's teamed on defense with Ryan Suter. There's Patrick Kane, the NHL's MVP, on the line with Derek Stepan and James Van Riemsdyk to start this game, and they hold the puck into the line again. Stepan mishandled it, turns and fires, and Yaro Halak makes his first save.
Jim, much has been made about this Team Europe and the way that they're going to have to play to try to be successful. It's not turning the puck over. Roman Josi, you mentioned the best of their defense offensively, but it's James Van Riemsdyk who does a nice job of turning it over. And one thing that Ralph Kruger will be having his team is real puck control, not allowing any easy offense for this USA team. Jim, you think of the exhibition head-to-head in the first two games for U.S. against Canada. This is almost a polar opposite, isn't it? A team that you're not necessarily know that well and not that into.
And they really don't have the pace up early in the game yet, do they?
No, I thought the exhibition started with a real bang with Canada and the U.S. And the challenge here for the U.S. is to have that same kind of intensity here against a team they don't know all that well.
Joe Pavelski won the faceoff. There's our Zach Parise. Blake Wheeler, the new captain of the Winnipeg Jets, is parked out in front of the net up against Kopitar's line. He'll probably play a lot. This is their second shift of the game already. Here's Marian Hossa. Crisscrossing with Thomas Tatar, and the play is broken up by Jack Johnson, teamed on defense with Eric Johnson. There's Eric, number six. His pass to center, tipped by Wheeler, in on Halak, and he'll play the puck to the boards. Christian Ehrhoff. Mark Streit moves the puck around on the boards. There are three defensemen on this European team that are 35 plus and may not have the speed that they once had. Ehrhoff still got the shot, and he takes it. And there's the first one on Jonathan Quick.
Jim, what you see early on here from the Americans is really try to put offensive pressure in on Team Europe, but force their defense, as you mentioned, maybe a little bit older, maybe looking over their shoulder a bit. The defensemen are pinching down. The forwards are being aggressive. And these kind of plays in traffic are what the European team are going to have to make. Kopitar is such a good two-dimensional player. He plays at both ends of the ice, and these are the plays down low in their own end that Europe are going to have to make to get out.
Leon Draisaitl had a hat trick in Team Europe's only win in the Greek tournament, and he's on the ice right now on a line that does have some speed with Lino Niederreiter, Tobias Reeder, Brandon Dubinsky on a roughly tumbled fourth line. Got the puck to Matt Niskanen. He dumped it in. David Backes is on this line as well. And so is Justin Abdelkader. And they'll try and get in on the forecheck. And they're in on that now. Dennis Seidenberg broke the play up. Lifts the puck to center. Watch the Europeans. They'll try and check. And the slower this game is, the better it is for them. They found out against Team North America right away that there better not be a track meet because they'll finish second.
Yeah, it is one matchup, though, Jim, that Draisaitl line against the fourth line of the Americans that you're trying to at least get something going offensively for Team Europe.
Kessler's line is back, but this time he won't be out there against Andre Kopitar's line. Pierre-Edouard Belmar from France out with Yannick Hansen and Thomas Vanek into the attacking zone. Hansen knocked the puck down, ran into TJ Oshie and got the puck deep. Belmar battling with John Carlson. Turns back, shields the puck from Ryan Kessler. Up the boards, Oshie with a chip, and then he tripped over Zdena Chara. There's an intercepted pass. Max Pacioretty and Halak came up to help. Ryan Kessler with a shot, a weak one that was blocked, and Andre Sekera got the puck to center ice. Norwegian Mats Zuccarello, his team qualified for the Olympics, and 12 of these European players played Olympic qualifiers just before they came over for training camp for the World Cup. Eric Stepan. James Van Riemsdyk played only half a season for the Maple Leafs because he broke a foot, and he's worked his way up the lineup since training camp started for the World Cup. He's on a pretty good line now with Stepan and Kane. Zuccarello overskated the puck. There's Marian Gabrin. Just about painted himself in the corner, but he made the play, got the puck out. Racing through the neutral zone, Franz Nielsen. Gabrick in front, scores! A two-on-one, and there's a couple of Europeans that do have speed. Marian Gabrick makes it 1-0 for Europe.
As John Tortorella looks up at the board, he wants to see this again. It's decisions in the neutral zone. As you see here, Ryan McDonagh goes in on his teammate Zuccarello. Instead, doesn't get the puck, doesn't get the body, and a two-on-one ensues. Stepan can't get back quick enough. Franz Nielsen with a perfectly threaded pass, and Gabrick with his stick on the ice. What a start for Jonathan Quick. The first shot of the game is one cross crease and right in the back of the net.
So the Americans wanted a quick, aggressive start. They don't get it. And a patient Team Europe with a nice breakout. The tip, Zuccarello and Nielsen set up Gabrick 1-0.
Right on game plan for Team Europe. Just play a good, solid defensive effort. That play was made from a nice job in the defensive zone, alleviating pressure, moving the puck up. And for John Tortorella and his team, that aggressiveness, you've got to
be careful in the neutral zone to allow those odd man rushes.
That was Gabrick, who made a smart play down in front of his own net when he was double teamed and made the pass to the defense, then got up ice in a hurry and got the first goal. Now with some confidence, Tatar to Hossa. And there's Roman Josi, number 59. It's a return pass. It slipped by him. Seidenberg shot, and that's a tough save for Jonathan Quick. And the Europeans feel pretty good about themselves right now.
And a really important one for Quick as well. You can't fault the American goaltender on the goal. You can see the puck movement by the Europeans side to side, some traffic in front by Tatar, and a really important one for Quick. The referee cam is something that we've been able to bring back for the World Cup, and it gives you just a great perspective of just how quickly things happen and open up at ice level.
So on the head of Kelly Sullivan, all of the officials in the game are Canadians, and all of the officials in the tournament are from the NHL. Dubinsky, Abdelkader, and Backes trying to get out of their own zone, but the Americans have been pinned here for a couple of shifts. There's Jack Johnson with a hard pass that's picked off as the Europeans cut off all the lanes in the neutral zone.
And Jim, don't you think just the absolute worst start you could have for the American team? All the pressure, you heard Scott Oak talk about, it's time now for John Tortorella and his American team. The disappointment of Sochi Olympics, they were shut out in their last two games, that dramatic 1-0 Canada win and then disappointing loss to the Finns in the bronze medal game, and here they find themselves behind once again.
I think they might be a little nervous to start this tournament.
I think so, and I think it's a tough opponent because it's not one that you have a natural rivalry with. You almost have to build one up yourself, and getting down early in these short tournaments is never something that's easy to respond to.
Matt Zuccarello summed up Team Europe by saying it's kind of odd to play for a continent, not a country. And I'm sure that's the way the U.S. feels right now. They're playing against a continent. Wheeler with a shot. And Jaro Halak makes a nice save and stops play as the Americans try and strike back.
And, Jim, to me, that's what they have to get back to, is getting their legs moving, stretch the puck up. That's a quick attack that starts once again with a good breakout in the neutral zone. Stretch pass that backs the D up. And here's Jaroslav Halak, who's going to be a real key contributor for the European team and their chances, and there's a good early save for Halak to get himself into it.
Pierre-Edouard Bellemare comes on. He played a very important role for Philadelphia on a fourth line with Chris Vandevelde and Ryan White last season in the playoffs. Kessler with a shot. Halak with the save. TJ Oshie in behind the net wearing number 74. Max Pacioretty's in front of the goal as Oshie stops and then lobs the puck in. Pacioretty plays it to the back of the net. Dennis Seidenberg looking for an NHL job, an unrestricted free agent, to Bellemare and to Josi, who steps up quickly to center. Yeah, Yannick Hansen going to the front of the net, trying to feed him, couple of bounces, and that could have been tough for Jonathan Quick, but Pacioretty knocked the puck in behind the net. Johnson to Kessler, makes a nice move. Here's Oshie, he's got Pacioretty, stops up and shoots, and that was blocked by defenseman Christian Ehrhoff. Josi. Ehrhoff with some room to step up. Drops the puck out to the goal scorer, Gabrick. No room for him. John Carlson had a tight gap and knocked the puck away. Mark Streit, 38-year-old defenseman. John Carlson up the middle. Not much room in the neutral zone right now. And the Americans forced to dump the puck in. Van Riemsdyk did that. Step on, forechecking. Patrick Kane is there as well. And Gabrick will start a breakup. Long pass for Zuccarello, knocked down by Ryan Suter. Carlson up the middle. Gabrick tried to stop Kane. Leon Draisaitl's just come out of the ice, and he plays the puck back to Sekera. Backhanded up the board. Draisaitl cut off, but he played the puck into the middle. Gabrick's at the end of his shift, and he dumps the puck in. Goal scored at 4:19 by Marion Gabrick, and Team Europe has its first ever goal in international competition. Here's Draisaitl into the middle, out of the reach of Toby Reeder. Chance for Chara to shoot. He wanted the puck and didn't quite get it from Mino Niederreiter. Niederreiter heads for the front of the net. Reeder working in the corner against Blake Wheeler. Good shift here for Draisaitl's line. Cycle is broken by McDonough, and the USA gets the puck and gets up. Pavelski to Wheeler with Parisi. Puck goes deep. Chara had a look around, and he plays the puck up the boards. One and done for the Americans And their top line, or one of their top lines, is sent back to center and must change again.
Already you see the improved structure of this European team. Their first two games, as you mentioned, with all the players playing in different places, coming from different areas, they were a little out of sync. And right now, much better structure defensively to their game.
Marian Hossa, a little tip on the boards. Kopitar can't get out against Kessler. There's that matchup again. Thomas Tatar waits at center. Kopitar has Josi right behind him. He heard him. Hossa's out front. Tatar's out front. Kopitar, Tatar, and his stick was checked by TJ Josi just at the last second. Tatar to the blue line. Josi on the other side. The shot by Seidenberg went wide of the net. And again, the USA can't get out of its own zone. And when they do, they turn the puck over at center and now must change. Almost 9 minutes into the game, two shots each.
I would guess on that American bench, if I'm John Tortorella, get the pace going. Get your legs moving and try to amp up the speed of this game. Right now, the European team has been able to maintain control.
And it's Hansen. Cut off a breakout. Couldn't let Pavelski out of his own zone. Erhoff kept the puck in. Eric Johnson steps up to center. Brandon Dupinski rink wide. Here's Justin Abdel-Kader of the Red Wings. In comes David Backes of the Boston Bruins to the blue line. There's a shot. Halak made the save off of Matt Niskanen. McDonough on the other side held the puck in for the USA. He's got it again. Niskanen couldn't get the one-timer away, then his shot was blocked by Hansen. Abdel-Kader pinned by Mark Streit. That's what this American line is built for. Some board battles, and they win this one. Niskanen in from the blue line, threw the puck out front, wanted a ricochet, didn't get it. Dupinski with a shot. That ricocheted off a shin guard. Niskanen again holds the puck in. The U.S. needs a change. And so does Team Europe. And Erhoff gets the puck off the glass and out. Both teams finish up changes. Halfway through the first period of Game 1, Group A, that also includes Canada and the Czech Republic, and Team Europe has a 1-0 lead. Zdeno Chara. The blue line, Ryan Suter in front of the net. Kane takes the shot, waited too long, was waiting for a screen, I think, and didn't get it. Halak made the save. Marian Gaborik has the first goal of the World Cup of Hockey in Toronto.
World Cup in 30, presented by Visa Checkout, tonight.
It's cliche, but every coach in this tournament has said there's no easy games in the World Cup of Hockey, and Team USA is finding that out about Team Europe that they don't know much about, and they're behind one another.
No, it's a difficult start, and it's not as emotional a start as even the exhibition series was, but one of the great new technologies is the chips inside the players' sweaters, and here's Marian Gaborik, who, as you mentioned, Jim, started the play in his own zone, gets up to 32 kilometers an hour, go to the net with your stick on the ice, and good things happen. Nilsson with the perfect pass. And Europe with a perfect start.
And the Americans won the faceoff after a six-minute span without a whistle. There's Blake Wheeler with a sharp-angled shot, tipped just wide by Joe Pavelski. Andrzej Kopitar, the lone Slovenian in the NHL in the World Cup, sends the puck down the ice, trying to make a pass. Instead, it's an icing call.
The fifth season is when kids dream big. That's why we're a proud sponsor of the World Cup of Hockey, with over 8,000 community teams across Canada.
The first thing everybody would have said in handicapping this game is that the USA is faster, but they haven't been so far.
No, and that look on the bench with all three coaches with their heads down writing or talking says a lot too, doesn't it?
TJ Oshie works his way out front. Here's Matt Niskanen with a shot. Halak found that in a crowd of bodies in front of the net. Ryan McDonough couldn't hold the puck in. Here's Thomas Tatar. Kopitar's with him. Tatar. Kopitar had his stick hooked out of his hands. And the Americans down 1-0, chasing back to their own net, take a penalty, and Ryan Kessler is going to the box.
And here's the frustration. Offensively, you get your really first best chance is TJ Oshie off the draw of Kessler. Kessler goes to the net, Oshie back to the point. Look at the effort by Halak fighting through Kessler to get to it. But once again, it's a pinch by McDonough at the blue line that gets caught. Oshie's losing body position. Nilsson with another good play, and a sprawling Kessler in. Might have saved a goal, but forced to take a penalty. Something that the European team didn't draw much of in their three games. Just 5 power plays in their first 3 games.
Really not much happened in their games. They didn't take penalties, they didn't get power plays. Shorthanded, and here's Blake Wheeler. Kessler in the penalty box, the first power play of the World Cup. Eric Stepan, Wheeler. So the penalty killers play a little keep away. And now the power play finally gets to center. Marian Gabrick, he's got Leon Draisaitl with him. Jumping into the middle is Franz Nielsen. 4 forwards and a defenseman, and you'll see that with just about every power play in this tournament. Matt Zuccarello, lone defender. There's Nielsen with a shot, and a nice save by Quick on Franz Nielsen. Lone defender on this power play has the puck right now. It's Mark Streit, and he's an offensive defenseman with a big shot.
Good check. Nielsen. That's a good check.
Gabrick after that good pick. Zuccarello has straight back at the blue line. Draisaitl in the middle. Gabrick, Zuccarello to Draisaitl off the leg and out, and the American penalty killers get a chance to change a minute into the penalty.
Just 3 shots on goal, but 1 goal against Quick, and the other 2 saves were great saves. He's forced to make another good one as Franz Nilsson's had a good first period.
Kopitar's out on the power play now. Marian Hossa is with him. Thomas Vanek is there, and Thomas Tatar. Roman Josi, the lone defender on this second look on the power play. Hossa, watched by Brandon Dubinsky. Nice play there from Kopitar to Hossa to the front of the net. And Tatar couldn't get a shot. He was checked.
Yeah, Tatar didn't realize that he had Thomas Vanek right on the doorstep, too. Vanek was yelling, and at the last second, Tatar couldn't make the pass.
Slowly they move in again. Andrzej Kopitar dropped the puck back, and Josi's got to chase it. Halak comes out to meet the puck. David Backes forechecking shorthanded. Thomas Tatar and an American change. Late in the power play, Kessler's back on. Team Europe 0 for 1 in the power play, but they have the puck from the blue line. Long shot by Sekera. That was blocked. And a second attempt, he backhands the puck in deep. Eric Johnson to Ryan Suter. Minnesota teammate Parisi's checked at center. Pavelski's after the puck. He was named the American captain. He's captain of the San Jose Sharks. 4 NHL captains on this U.S. team, including the most recently named Blake Wheeler. Carlson's back to the puck under pressure from Tobias Wieder. Pavelski, center in support, got checked. Franz Nielsen in great position. Nice pass. Josi moves in. Threw the puck out front. Yannick Hansen couldn't get his stick on it. Here's Patrick Kane. Has yet to dazzle so far in the game. Centering pass off the skate. And a bouncing puck eluded Ryan McDonough. Now he's got to get back. And Hansen was at the end of the shift and couldn't pursue him any further. Here's Derek Stepan, shoveled the puck towards the net. Van Riemsdyk couldn't get to it. Matt Niskanen into the middle. McDonough fakes and takes, and Zuccarello stayed right with it. His New York Ranger teammate now goes after him in the corner. Van Riemsdyk, Pacioretty in back. And Halak, and that pass that was headed for the front of the net for Franz Nielsen, decides to cover up. Franz Nielsen, the latest member of the Red Wings, and Kenny Holland will like what he sees so far, as RefCam does as well.
To go from running a soccer team in England's Premiership to coaching a World Cup hockey team. After a brief tenure as head coach of the Edmonton Oilers, he took over as chairman of the Southampton Football Club. His major challenge with Team Europe here, bringing different nationalities together. He's not without qualifications, as Southampton takes in 15 different nationalities, Jim, so he knows about melding a team.
Yeah, a big game against Swansea tomorrow. I'm sure you'll get a chance to watch that. Pierre-Edouard Bellemare. He's from France. He's with an Austrian, Thomas Vanek. And a Dane, Yannick Hansen. And they're on the attack. The Europeans have been wonderfully structured so far in the game. So Ralph and his coaching staff, that includes Paul Maurice and Brad Shaw, who now works with Columbus, have done a terrific job in a short period of time.
And I think the common theme with all the coaching staffs, but even more so because of the uniqueness of the European group, is you don't want to overcoach too quickly. You don't want to give too much information. I think early on it was important, Jim, in those first two games, that his team was a little out of sync, that he didn't overreact. Just gave the guys some time, allowed the veterans, and did an awful lot of coaching off the ice to try to bring everybody together.
Craig, they were 2 or 3 days later than the other teams with their training camp. Here's a 2-on-1. Zuccarello, Nielsen, and he's stopped by Jonathan Quick. Another 2-on-1 and another one featuring this same line. Ehrhoff with a shot. Quick picked that up at the last second and kicked it out. And the U.S. gets the puck to center. Mark Streit is there to shoot the puck back in.
That's one quick way of getting the United States to back off their aggressiveness a bit. Their D have been trying to pinch in to keep the offense going, but as you mentioned, at least 3 2-on-1s, one of them in the back of the net, and if not for Jonathan Quick and another excellent save, it would be a 2-0 game.
Matt Zuccarello, Marion Gaborik, Franz Nielsen, the top line on Team Europe so far in this game. That's Zuccarello with his unmistakably long stick. Nielsen stoned by Quick. Could easily have been 2-0. Instead, it's 1-0 for Europe at the World. English, these players are all used to that. And as much as they're not used to necessarily playing in this format on Europe, they are all from countries where they're used to having to go elsewhere to play.
Yes, and so it's not unusual in that regard. And I think they've just considered themselves the underdogs. The North American under 24 team is a little bit of a... got a lot of interest, so it's a great motivator for this group to just get out there and play, and they've certainly started off with a bang.
Andre Kopitar's played 5 minutes of the first period. Long pass at center out of the reach of Thomas Tatar. There's an icing call against the Europeans with 3.5 minutes to go in period number one.
Well, the challenge now for the United States is to just put a sequence of shifts together. We saw the fourth line have one good shift, and then the Kane line came out and couldn't get anything going offensively. Here you get an icing call. Kessler's line comes out, and this is for John Tortorella. You got to start getting some traction here as he looks on and hasn't seen much positive yet.
Haven't had a shift where the Europeans have been really pinned in their own zone unless the puck was on the boards. Kessler, good face-off man, won the draw. John Carlson, little bounce pass to Oshie. His shot knocked down. Oshie's after the puck. Kopitar had a look around, and he flips the puck out. Ryan Suter has to wait. Cross-ice pass to Carlson. Pacioretty centering pass. Knocked down, and Marian Hossa is back for the puck. Everybody on Team Europe is back. Josi couldn't get the puck out. And there's Halak, sensing a little trouble coming, so he stops play.
Well, a common theme and a common frustration here for the United States is look at all the blue sweaters that you've got to go through. You win a draw, you get to the front of the net, and the collapse back in the defensive zone. All five European players not allowing the puck to get through. Oshie trying to battle and find a shooting lane, and a couple of good blocks to help prevent any extra shots on Yaroslav Halak.
Americans have won 11 of 16 faceoffs in the game. David Backes playing the wing here, but a centerman comes in to try and get that draw, and the Americans win the loss. Abdul Kader and Dubinsky battle. There, Edouard Bellemare in the middle of the battle. So is Mark Streit. Dubinsky, Eric Johnson shot, ricocheted and went just wide. Leon Draisaitl, backhand pass and a beauty to center. Mark Streit goes wide through the puck at the net, a deflection. Hustling to the puck is Ehrhoff, and he threw it to the front of the net. Blocked before it got there. Abdul Kader to Eric Johnson, can't get out. Ehrhoff keeps the puck in. Jack Johnson. Around to David Backes as the Europeans change. And on comes that line. It's been so good so far in the game. Zuccarello, Franz Nielsen, Marion Gaborik. And they assume a defensive position. Niskanen slowly to center. All of the Europeans are back. Halak slows the puck up. Van Riemsdyk, Kane, Stepan come after the puck. Chara off the boards and out. Could have been another two-on-one there. Zuccarello could have reached for that puck. Europeans have had a couple of odd man rushes. One of them got them a goal. Americans haven't had one of those yet. And not much sustained pressure. Here's Kane trying to remedy that. Drops the puck off. McDonough with a shot wide of the net.
Good checking, guys.
It is good checking. Kane forced to the outside. Cross ice thrown to the front of the net. Van Riemsdyk was there, couldn't get a stick on it. As Stepan fired the puck.
Hey, hey!
Matt Niskanen. And Ryan McDonough, the Europeans change again. As we approach the final minute of the first period of the World Cup, the only goal scored by Marian Gaborik. Niskanen shooting. Tatar is there to Seidenberg. Kopitar drops the puck off. Tatar called for it, got it. Seidenberg takes the shot. Bounces around in front of the net off some sticks. Hosses after the puck. Puck finally comes loose. Pavelski. John Carlson jumps up at center and he couldn't get over the blue line. Seidenberg stayed right with him. Tatar comes back the other way. Cross ice pass was knocked out of the air by Parisi. Turning and firing is Belmar with a bid. And that went into the corner as the Europeans try to finish up a change here. They'll all get a chance for a break after the first period. Team Europe played a structured game, got a 1-0 lead on a goal by Marian Gaborik. So the USA has some work to do in game one. Ron?
All right, Jim and Craig, thanks very kindly. You know, Team Europe got off to a rough start in this tournament, lost their first game 4-0 in Quebec City to Team North America, could have been 12-0, and then they fell 7-4, but there was a meeting in the second game in Montreal. Franz Nielsen gathered around the troops when the score was 5-1 for Team North America. Chara comes in, Matt Zuccarello had a great first period. Here's Nielsen again when the score was 5-2, helped engineer a 5-3 goal. He had a tremendous first period. The man who acquired him for Detroit, Ken Holland, joins us in our first intermission next. Back in the World Cup of Hockey, a reminder this evening, it's the first game for Team Canada against the Czech Republic. We'll be on the air here at Air Canada Centre, 7:30 Eastern. Donald S. Cherry along in the coach's corner. That's game two of our day today, the Czechs and the Canadians. Ken Holland's on the management team for Team Canada. There's only room for one Medicine Hat Tiger on the panel. So Kelly Rooney's going to have a coffee and enjoy Ken joining Nick and Elliot. And Elliot, your thought here.
Well, just Ken, it's 1-0 here, but only two of the four teams move on for each pod. I just got to think that if you're down 1-0 after the first period in a game like this, it's stressful. It's tense in that U.S.
Well,
room.
Things are going to happen quick. You really can afford one loss in the round robin. If you lose two games, you're not going to advance. So they're like playoff games. You know, we all had three pre-tournament games to find our game, and tonight's a playoff. So certainly it's going to happen quick. The round robin's over on Thursday, so it's a big week.
Ken, we know you're here representing Canada, but you can't help think about certain guys, members of your Detroit Red Wings. Do you think about the experience for a guy like Tatar coming into this tournament and what it could mean moving forward back on your hockey club?
Oh, without a doubt. I think it's, you know, when you're in your mid-20s, low-20s, we got Dylan Larkin, obviously, with the under the North American team. Fabulous experience to play against the best players in the world. You know, looks like Tats is on their second line here, so he is in the second power play. Great experience, great for their confidence heading back. And obviously watching Franz Nielsen and Vanek, two players that we acquired this summer. So obviously it's all about the World Cup in Canada, but you do have an eye on certain players.
Well, let's just have one comment about Canada tonight against the Czechs, because if the Americans thought this was the gimme, I don't think you'd ever consider the Czechs an easy out, but are you concerned about this game tonight?
Oh, yeah, very concerned. I don't think there's any gimmies in this tournament. you know, these are all the best players. I also think every goalie, every team has a goalie that can beat you. You can outplay and outshoot a team, and you can get beat by a goalie. And I think that's the beauty. These are the best goalies in the world. The goalies are the equalizer, so I don't think anybody's going to pull away from anybody. Again, I think they're playoff games every night. It's 1-0 here after one period. It's tight checking. Not a lot of scoring chances. It's going to be tough to win a game.
Ken, we know the ask and the demand right from the get-go is huge on the players, but are you even surprised at the intensity so early in these pre-tournament games?
No, I think anytime you're up. You know, we were in Columbus there the first pre-tournament game. It was like a Stanley Cup playoff game. It was physical. It was hard. And the next night we went back into Ottawa, it was the same thing. So it's best on best. These are proud athletes. They're representing their country. I'm not surprised.
Here's some work defensively by Team Europe in the first period. The shots, Elliott, 6-5 for the USA. That's it. So there was not a lot of getting through. And Ken Tatar, your man down on the right wing boards, helping out defensively. It's a bit of a gamble, but works out for the Europeans. And you saw a lot of that. Their wingers, Marian Gavrik, obviously set up the first goal by helping out. It'll be the third highlight here. Just what the Europeans have done to shut down the U.S. What do you think?
Well, you've got real good coaches, and I think you get into these tournaments. You know, we've got five of the best coaches in the world exchanging ideas. So everybody plays a tight game, and the down low, they take your space away, and that's the equalizer: goaltending and taking the other team's space away. And everybody's going to do it.
General managers and coaches are natural warriors. That's what you guys do. What could happen? Is there anything you look at with Team Canada and you say, this concerns me as you prepare the first game tonight?
Well, I think what concerns you is how fast the tournament's going to go. Our pool's playing today. We play the U.S. on Tuesday. By Tuesday night, you could be into a must-win situation. So it's three games. You got to win two minimum. Obviously, you want to win three to win your pool and get the first seed. I just think if things happen quick. I think that's the biggest concern, is you got to get it going fast, find your game. And at times there in the first period, it looked like the U.S. was going with three lines. You know, you're trying to get the people that are going as quickly as you can. So I think it's just how fast the tournament goes.
Ken, these are the Sports Vision pucks. As you know, the players have a Band-Aid with a chip in their uniform to measure how fast they skate. We have 700 of these pucks as well to determine how hard every shot is, and there's all kinds of metrics that they are measuring and we'll be featuring on our telecast. But Marian Gavrik, as Craig Simpson showed, went end-to-end on that one goal. There's his speed. It was an incredible, because you went back to game one of this tournament, the pre-tournament in Quebec. This was him with Kyle Bukauskas. Dying. I mean, dying.
We knew what they're bringing to the table. So, you know, they're chipping pucks. I think we have to do more of that as well. You know, we created a couple chances. But Yara was a very good first 20 minutes. So just have to keep plugging and get better.
Aaron, thanks for your time.
Yeah, thanks.
They look good now, Ken. Do you think that it's an edge for the North American team, the young 23 and under team, in this fast, hard tournament?
Well, obviously, their speed is going to be a real advantage. Obviously, they played the world team and played pretty well those first two games. We were at the game in Pittsburgh on Wednesday night. We played the second game of a doubleheader. As the game wore on, you know, the kids were coming in waves, and I think they had 45 shots. So they've got a lot of speed. They're going to play with a lot of enthusiasm. They're going to be a handful. But I think any of the eight teams can get out of the pool. And when you get into a semifinal game, it's one game. We talked about goaltending. You get into one game is shot. You know, you can outplay the other team and lose the game. Best of seven series, you got a chance to lose a game or two. So it's going to be a fabulous tournament, and it's up for grabs.
I was wrong. It's not one medicine hat tiger. It's one goalie. Only room for one goalie on the panel. Thank you, Ken. Architect of the 98, obviously 2002 and 2008 Detroit Red Wings Stanley Cups, and a member of Team Canada here. Franz Nielsen. On the other side of the break with Scott Oak. It's 1-0 Team Europe leading the USA after 20 minutes. They'll play the Czechs next on Monday and then Canada on Wednesday. The Canadians play Tuesday and Wednesday. But that's Europe. Let's go to Franz Nielsen, Scott Oak.
Ron, your line in particular made life very difficult for the Americans in the opening 20 minutes. What's a period like that do for Team Europe's confidence?
A lot. We knew they were going to come out hard on us, and we just told each other to be patient in there and, you know, be smart. And we knew that, yeah, like I said, we knew they were going to be aggressive. We were going to get some odd man chances the other way.
For the most part, USA has been unable to generate sustained offense. What's working for you in your own end of the rink?
Yeah, same thing. I think we're patient. We, you know, guys are doing the job in there. We're staying in shooting lanes, and we're, you know, playing tight in front of Yarrow. So just trying to make it tough for them, not give them too much time.
Thanks, Franz. Appreciate your time.
Thanks, guys. Thanks.
Okay, Kelly, what'd you see?
Well, Ken Holland talked about the speed and how important that is, but individual speed isn't very good unless you have support. And we're going to see a real fine clip of this from Team Europe and how they're all working together. And we've heard this line many, many times about five guys working together. And Reeder, the first guy on, Carlson has no time whatsoever. But if Hansen doesn't come in here and strip him of the puck, then they don't get the scoring opportunity from Josi, which he does so well. Always sneaks in from the point. Now, it doesn't turn into anything, but collect. If you keep doing that time and time again, it wears down the other team.
You know, Nick, you talked in the pregame about how John Tortorella told you that Patrick Kane had a longer leash offensive than all the other guys. He didn't take one offensive draw in that first period. They mainly used the Kessler, Oshie, Pacioretty line for four of the seven they had. I wonder if he unleashes Kane moving on.
And I wonder if they're going to look back at this game and say, did we make a mistake not putting Byfuglien in? Because I think Team Europe grew about 2 inches when they found out he was a healthy scratch here. Where's all that momentum from that physicality we saw in the pre-tournament? We didn't see it in the first 20 minutes.
As you know, that was the key to the deal in 1996 when the Americans with their size gave Canada fits. Scott, I was going to touch on that a little bit when we come back on the other side of the break. And as you mentioned, Kelly, the Team Europe, eight nations on that team, proving five sticks is better than one as they grab the early.
Game one of the 2016 World Cup, one period complete. Team Europe has the USA on its heels. Team Europe leading 1-0. It's a nice move by USA head coach John Tortorella to ensure that each of his players was given a thumb drive last month, containing the video of America's stunning win over Canada in the 96 World Cup. Patrick Kane was 7 when that game was played, so it was his first chance to witness great moments like these from Tony Amonte and Mike Richter. Max Pacioretty said yesterday, watching the game proved to him the World Cup should not be taken as just a glorified training camp, but rather a chance to achieve greatness as the 96 team did. But now let's go back to that quote by Ralph Kruger earlier today. We're ready to look into the eyes of America. And so far, Jim, Team Europe is winning the stare down.
Done a pretty nice job. Elliott alluded to it in the first intermission. I wonder if they'll turn Patrick Kane loose. There are 6 forwards on Team USA that played more than Kane in the first period. He was on the ice for the goal against, but you would think that they want to get him into the game very quickly.
The only concern I would have is the way that the U.S. played there, and you heard Franz Nielsen talk about it a little bit with Scott Oak, is they were able to pick apart the mistakes being too aggressive at the wrong time. And sometimes in these quick tournaments, you try too hard to make things happen, and you are vulnerable at the other end.
Kane spent a lot of the pre-tournament playing with Joe Pavelski. I thought they might get back to that in a hurry, but they haven't. There's his shot as the U.S. moved in and step on. Van Riemsdyk still out there with Patrick Kane. Team Europe gets to set it. Franz Nielsen to Marion Gaborik with a hot shot that missed the net from an angle that sends the puck all the way back down into Team Europe zone.
And that's what you're seeing a lot of from Team Europe, is that transition and speed through the neutral zone. And there's another good example of it here to start the second.
Defensively in the neutral zone, they've been very good. Not much room. The thing about this team, they may not be the fastest team, and they are a bit different because they're from so many different countries, but they're the third most experienced team, and there's 8 Stanley Cups in this lineup, so they know how to play the game.
And they're playing a very smart game, a strategic game, not overplaying, and the real key for the United States is to start pressuring some of those older defense, a little slower defense, and start picking that apart.
But the Americans haven't been able to really dictate the pace of the game. Niskanen. McDonough with a shot. Halak makes the save. There's a rebound. Kessler barged in and got a hold of that. Anaheim ducked Kessler with a shot that was blocked. McDonough couldn't get a shot. It would have been blocked. Then he gets checked and knocked down. Here's another two-on-one. Andrzej Kopitar. Tatar's in front. What a great defensive play by Washington's Matt Niskanen. Saved the day on the third two-on-one of the game for the Europeans.
Yeah, the United States wanted a penalty there as McDonough got knocked down, and that's what created that chance, Jim. Good read, though, aggressively by Niskanen going down.
There, Edward Pelmar. Back to the puck. Pavelski's forechecking. And a deflection off a stick sent the puck out of the park.
Well, so far the European team has taken advantage of turnovers. And here's a tough play defensively. The fake by McDonough loses the puck. But right there, it's that hit that the U.S. wanted a penalty. Could have been called interference. It wasn't. But a smart play. As soon as Kopitar looked down at the puck, Niskanen had committed himself and had a good active stick. And too quick to get there for Kopitar to stop up and get his stick around his opponent.
Seidenberg took a hit as he dumped the puck in. Eric Johnson is back. Belmar closes on him in a hurry. Yannick Hansen right there for Team Europe as well. Roman Josi is back under pressure from Wiener. There's Belmar looking for Hansen. Couldn't get a handle on that puck, and then he got checked. And the Americans throw the puck to center. Seidenberg to Josi, and he dumps the puck back in. In the midst of a change, Gabrick's come on, Zuccarello's come on. Jack Johnson with a pass through center, and it's an icing call against the Americans.
And there's the Europeans taking away the speed of the Americans. In the first period, it was Europe's speed that was on full force, coming up through the neutral zone to score the game's first goal. We saw how quick that was. Thomas Tatar on a loose puck. Again, attacking the net, creating a penalty by the U.S. Another, Nielsen and Zuccarello getting up to 32, 33 kilometers for yet another scoring chance. They have just opened up the middle of the ice so far in this game.
So it's interesting that speed has been a factor in the game, but it's favored the Europeans.
And I really would not have thought that coming in. I thought they would have been the slower of the two teams, but so far it hasn't been the case.
But it hasn't gone end-to-end, and if that happens, they probably are the slower of the two teams. Opportunistic, have pounced, and the right guys have had the puck, and this line has been great. Here's another odd man rush, 3-on-2. Gabrick moves in, he shoots, and Quick made the save. Nobody came anywhere near Gabrick as he walked in. And Jonathan Quick had to make the save with his right shoulder. Here's Brandon Dubinsky at center. It's clogged up again, and so he can't control the puck in the attacking zone. Mark Streit to Franz Nielsen. To center, shoots the puck in and hits off on a change.
Isn't that a great example of faith in your goaltender? Just leave the shooter to your goaltender, take away that pass. And that's exactly what the Americans did, and Quick was equal to the pass.
Patrick Kane is back on. Ryan Suter fed in the puck. Cuts in the middle, turns, shoots! Halak may have got a wee piece of that to steer it aside. First win, a good chance for Kane. Here he is again. He's with Dubinsky and Abdelkader. And he's going to do a lap. MVP Patrick Kane closed off, and this is a 2-on-0 the other way. Leon Draisaitl in front, gets it back and scores. Just when it looked like Patrick Kane might get something for Team USA, a 2-on-0 that turned into a 3-on-0. 2-0 Europe.
There's the danger. You just try to do too much individually. The great effort by Kane gets a good look at the net. Halak didn't even see it, but he's able to get a piece of it. Now a 1-on-2. The Europeans chip and chase, and here's a nice little give and go. Look at the effort by Quick at the last second to try to get back. He had to be respectful of this cross seam being a shot. Tried desperately to come back, and credit Draisaitl with getting that puck just up and over the pad of Jonathan Quick.
Reeder and Niederreiter should get assists on Draisaitl's first goal. And 2-0 on the sixth odd man rush that Team Europe has had in the game. Six. How will the Americans handle this? You heard Kenny Holland talk about it. You can't lose two games. They lose this game, and then they must beat Canada. And now there's a penalty being called.
And part of the thing that you try to preach on your bench is just calm. You hear it so often. You try to do too much, and bad things happen.
You see Kane try to do it himself, and it ends up on a 3-on-0. Kessler trying to get involved offensively. No sense in reaching there. That's Belmar about 150 feet from his own net. Not a threat, and instead you give another opportunity for the Europeans to try to add to their lead.
Gave up 16 power plays in three pre-tournament games. Now two in this game, both penalties to Ryan Kessler. And the puck's out of play, so the Europeans with a wonderful opportunity to get a 3-0 lead with a power play.
Yeah, this is almost a critical play here for the United States. You have to kill this penalty off. You know you've got good players. You know you've got skill and experience, but you just can't try to get ahead of yourself and do too much.
Kopitar, Hossa, Tatar up front. Vanek plays back with Roman Josi, the lone defenseman. Thomas Vanek winds up and fires. I don't think Quick can see that, but it whistled by his ear. Anze Kopitar with the puck in the power play. Josi gives him the puck back. Roman Josi again. Kopitar with some room. Couldn't get the shot. Josi feeds the puck in. A cross-ice pass just missed Tatar. And the Europeans are forced back to center. Americans make one change in the penalty kill. Backus has come on. Josi gets in with the puck. Kopitar around on the boards. And chasing the puck out to center is Thomas Vanek. Europeans will start a change in the power play. Kopitar into the middle. Good stick by David Backus. Got the puck to center. Christian Ehrhoff goes back into his own zone to wait for the power play change to finish. Johns Nielsen with some speed, stops up inside the line. He's got Zuccarello there with it. Gabrick has a man in front. It's Draisaitl, and the puck didn't get through. Here's Justin Abdelkader, one of four Red Wings in the game. It'll give and go. Niskanen to the net, and he's on the puck, but he couldn't get his stick on it shorthanded. Abdelkader tried to throw a big hit and just missed. Blake Wheeler plays the puck back. The last half minute, or approaching it, of this second power play, Wheeler shorthanded. As Van Riemsdyk with it. Slowly out of his own zone, Matt Zuccarello. Ehrhoff to center. Nielsen to Gabrick. Drop pass. Zuccarello couldn't come up with a puck. And USA clears it again. The penalty killers change up.
Really important next shift here for USA. Did an excellent job of stopping any momentum for the European team. Now you need a big shift offensively coming off a successful kill.
Kessler's back on. Team Europe 0-2 with a man advantage. Kessler stays out there with Pavelski and Parisi. Ryan Suter lugs the puck to center. His pass for Kessler missed him. And that's an icy call against Team USA. They won't be able to change, and they had a mix of a couple of different lines on the ice. Game number one, six straight days of two games a day, all at the Air Canada Centre. Two four-team pools, the top two teams go to the semifinals, and that's single game elimination. And tonight, Team Canada makes its first appearance against the Czech Republic at 8 Eastern time. 7:30 for our pregame show.
Lots of respect from Canada and the Czech Republic. They've been a spoiler nation many times internationally.
Andrei Sekera with a shot from the blue line. And off a leg and wide of the net. Pavelski. Parisi couldn't take the pass. Now he's at center, and once again, Europeans give him no room. So Suter steps up, helps out. Weak backhander, and Jaro Halak smothers the puck for a faceoff. Team Europe with a 2-0 lead. Marian Gaborik in the first period. Nino Niederreiter to Leon Draisaitl. 2-0 Europe in the second period of the World.
Oilers' Leon Draisaitl played in the shadow of Connor McDavid last season, so his 19 goals didn't get the attention they deserved. The World Cup is a chance for Draisaitl to get out of that shadow, and he started with a 2-0 goal here. Dreisaitl's got hockey bloodlines. His father, Peter, played for Germany in the Canada Cup back in 84 in a number of Olympic games, but Peter's on a much more talented team, Jim, and he's got a chance to make much more of an impact.
They've been waiting to see when Team USA would make some alterations. They've made one. McDonough to the front of the net. Max Pacioretty has moved onto this line in James Van Riemsdyk's spot with Stepan and Kane. They're playing defensively again against this Franz Nielsen line that has been Europe's best. Nielsen. Gabrick. Zuccarello. Matt Niskanen needs some help from Ryan McDonough and gets it, but the puck still didn't get out for Team USA. Zuccarello has stolen the puck. Gavrik's out front, but he's covered by Pacioretty. Oh, hard hit as Zuccarello's taken out hard by Matt Niskanen, and he's slow to get up, skating back into the play. Kane to center, chips the puck in. Back defensively is Andrei Kopitar. Seidenberg hard to center. Hossa lost the puck, but then got it back. Seidenberg up the middle. Roman Josi steps up through center. Hossa's with him. So is Thomas Tatar. Pavelski is back for the puck for Team USA. And it's stolen. Here's Tatar. Kopitar is parked in front of the net from the blue line. Seidenberg on the other side to Josi. Seidenberg, one-timer. Quick got a piece of that. Tatar got knocked down in pursuit of the rebound. And Pavelski gets the puck to send. Van Riemsdyk turned back by Roman Josi. Puck shot in, and Dennis Seidenberg is back as the Americans make a change. Hard to center. Vanek tips the puck in. Kopitar needs a change, trying to get to the bench. Eric Johnson. Oshie and Kane are out together now. Mixing and matching. He started on the Team USA bench. 3-on-3 to center.
There's the extra ice time for Kane we talked about.
Kane with Kessler in front. Halak gets across, got a piece of it, and Kessler got a piece of him. Kessler didn't know where the puck was. He thought it might be under Halak's pad, so he went back and had a look for it. It had gone to the corner. And it's Kessler, Oshie, and Kane on this forward line right now. Elias Reeder stripped to the puck. Patrick Kane got it back. Ryan Kessler, he missed the puck along the boards. Here's Niederreiter to center. Advanced the puck. Abdelkader is back. McDonough off the boards, not out. Turned over. Draisaitl into the middle. Christian Ehrhoff with a shot. Just missed. The hard wrist shot. McDonough got checked and knocked down. This is a forgettable shift for Ryan McDonough, and he could have taken a penalty there on Niederreiter. Again, the Americans can't get out of their own zone. Niederreiter forechecking. Draisaitl forechecking. Abdelkader finally gets the puck. Dubinsky at center. And Backes, Abdelkader move in. David Backes with a shot that hit Abdelkader and missed the net. Team Europe couldn't get the puck out of its own zone. Chara and Sekera are back. And Chara just threw the puck down the ice as Ryan Suter goes back. There's an icing call against Team Europe. Just outside of the Air Canada Center at Maple Leaf Square, there's a throne. Who will sit on the throne of the World Cup? We don't know which team will, but you can have your picture taken there, courtesy of SportCheck during the tournament.
Well, one of the rare chances here is a turnover in the neutral zone. Kane looking for an opportunity to get it across to Kessler, and you're right, Kessler thought it was underneath Halak, but Halak did a nice job of coming out and meeting Kessler and able to get the puck.
And Riemsdyk is back with Stepan and Kane for a shift. As the Americans desperately search for some offense, halfway through this game, they've got but 12 shots on goal. Europeans have only 7, but they've scored twice because they've been fabulous chances.
There's every second shift for Patrick Kane, as you're mentioning, as John Tortorella. That entire commercial break, he was writing notes and obviously looking for some different looks to try to get some offense going.
The Europeans continue to just play a patient game and wait for a U.S. mistake, and they've had a few. Andrei Sekera, check, the puck comes loose. Parisi with a centering pass. Pavelski in a bouncing puck, couldn't get a shot. Threw it back to the blue line. Niskanen to McDonough, and he trips a rolling puck in deep. Parisi gets the puck, a backhanded wraparound that's blocked. McDonough. Niskanen fires wide. A little pressure from the Americans on this shift. Pavelski held the puck in. Parisi's there. Niskanen comes in from the blue line, and finally the Europeans chip the puck out. This is the Kopitar line that was trapped in its own zone for about 30 seconds. Blake Wheeler slowly to center, drops the puck off and heads off in a change. Jack Johnson, Ryan McDonough, you'll change as you tip the puck in.
Too many men on the ice.
And that's called by the referee. They talk to the linesman.
The question is, which side?
Which side had too many men on the ice?
It's Europe, Team Europe.
So the Americans desperately needing a goal. Yet it went back quite a ways. There's too many men on the ice for Team Europe. And the first power play of the game for Team USA.
Well, right here, there's only five. Yeah. So it must have happened earlier. The arms went up for the linesman. So unless there's a mistake from the linesman, he's already indicating. So prior to that, there had to be two bodies that got exchanged for one finally. But what an opportunity for the United States to get themselves into this hockey game.
And some momentum in the game. They were 1-for-11 in the pre-tournament games. Pavelski turns, feeds the point. Carlson to Oshie, and he just missed on a one-timer. Parisi's parked in front of the net. Patrick Kane is on the ice. Four forwards and one D-man. That's Carlson, who has the puck. Over to Kane. Kicks the puck up. Round the outside. Joe Pavelski. San Jose Shark into the middle. TJ Oshie from the blue line. Parisi's parked in front of the net. Slowly, Kane moves in against Zdeno Chara. To the blue line, Carlson. One-timer, Pavelski, read perfectly by Halaki. He was already there and waiting. Parisi to Patrick Kane. Oshie's in the slot. Carlson's shot knocked down in front of the net. And quick to clear the puck is Andre Seger, and the power play will change up.
That was Zdeno Chara, who is in position in front there. Didn't even see it, Jim, but it hit him right in the stick and went harmlessly to the side of the net there.
Ryan Kessler on the second power play. Derek Stepan is with him. James Van Riemsdyk will go to the front of the net. Max Pacioretty is shooter. And Ryan Suter is back. But shorthanded. Belmar with a shot that took the stick out of Kessler's hand and broke its handle. That set it. Pacioretty. Kicked by Dennis Seidenberg. And a chance here for Yannick Hansen, who's a very good penalty killer with the Vancouver Canucks. Clears the puck down the ice. Van Riemsdyk. There's the shooting, but can they get it back? Halak up the boards. Kessler kept the puck in. Van Riemsdyk to the open side. Pacioretty got there. And gets a hold of the puck. Ryan Suter into the middle. Takes the shot. A deflection. Halak the save. The rebound into the net. But how did it get into the net? I think this one will come back. Remember, there is a coach's challenge. There will be a review, and there can be a challenge.
Well, James Van Riemsdyk was going hard to the net and then hit the body. The question is, did it go harmlessly off the body, or did he use his arms? Halak trying to clear it. Gets a little bit of pressure from Derek Stepan. Around the side, back to the front. Now watch all the traffic that comes in front. Seidenberg can't get the puck and win the battle. And here's the shot. It's right off the chest of Van Riemsdyk. So it has to be a distinct motion of knocking it in. You be the judge. I don't know, Van Riemsdyk to me might have just kept his chest pumped out there. Any forward motion? Right off his chest, off the head of Stepan in front and over Halak. This is a tough one.
Could it have hit his glove?
Here,
we'll
get a better look here.
Boy, that looks like it was batted in right there.
You know, things happen so quickly. The call on the ice seemed to be that it was a good goal, and it'll be half the movement of his forearm, but I thought it did look like it hit in his chest area. Van Riemsdyk puts his arms up. From behind, it's difficult to tell in that regard. You're right, Jim, because you see that right arm go up.
Then did it hit Stepan?
It did, but it's still, even if he knocked it in with his hand, that little tip off the head wouldn't count.
And so this is being closely looked at.
Going from above, I thought it did hit his chest. I think it'll be Stepan's goal if there is a good goal, as he's laughing right now on the bench because he just saw it on the big screen. And here's Kelly Sutherland with the call.
Upon video review, the puck is intentionally directed in the net off the body. This is an illegal goal. No goal.
Boy, I thought
just by puffing up his chest.
Yeah, I thought if you're not moving your arms, there was a little movement by his right hand you could see right there, but I thought too it hit him in the chest. To me, that should be a goal. It's so hard these days. Yeah, it hit right in almost the USA sign, then off the helmet of Stepan and in. But the league has decided no goal. That's a tough one for the United States, and Van Riemsdyk doesn't like it.
It would have been a power play goal. Instead, it's still 2-0, and there's only 1 second remaining in the U.S. power play.
Jim, so many times you see those reviews, and to me, that's just another example that, in my books anyways, that should be a goal. And I'm sure everybody on the United States bench feels the same.
Stepan was just saying that it was just a deflection and it hit me in the head.
Yeah.
Still 2-0. Penalty's over. Tatar was serving it. He's back on. 5-on-5 again. McDonough with a shot. There's a tip in front by Abdelkader. And Halak with a nice save. Abdelkader. Matt Niskanen wrist shot. Halak got a piece of that.
The intensity of the United States on this shift.
They're mad.
Yeah, they're mad. They got some energy.
Got some fans in the building that are on their side too. Roman Josi. Dennis Seidenberg. And out off the stick of Matt Zuccarello. There's Josi jumping up offensively to the net. And Quick makes the save. He hasn't been very busy, but he's given up a pair. Van Riemsdyk had it deflect off his body. They said it was intentional. Stepan saying, I scored. That's off my head. Day at the office for the Team USA defense.
No, and it's that fine line, Jim, of being aggressive at the right time. Ryan McDonough, aggressive in the neutral zone, but the pinch ends up with a 2-on-1 and the puck's in the back of the net. So you try again. The mandate is get pressure in the zone. Instead, puck gets by him. It's a 2-on-1. 1-on-2 gets knocked down and another odd man rush against, and then the physical play. The Europeans have been able to establish for the most part that physical play down low. A tough period and a half for number 27.
One goal on a 2-on-1, one goal on a 2-on-0, and a 2-0 lead. Two goals on 8 shots for Team Europe.
And a tough no goal. That's, yeah. Again, that last shift by the United States, probably the most angry and most aggressive. Let's see if they can keep it up.
Marion Gabrick, nice give and go. Couldn't control the puck. Zuccarello gave it back to him. And the Americans get to center. John Carlson standing up against him is Mark Streit. That was linesman Derek Amell working with Shane Heyer in the game today. The referees Kelly Sutherland and Gord Dwyer. Strike. Supported by Franz Nielsen. There's a turnover. Jack Johnson held the puck in. Van Riemsdyk shot that deflected and hit Halak. He didn't stop as much as it hit him. There's another shot by Van Riemsdyk and another deflection in front into the corner. TJ Oshie, Jack Johnson, Eric Johnson shot off the goaltender Halak and just wide of the net, and a Team Europe penalty as Joe Pavelski's knocked down to the side of the net and Christian Ehrhoff goes off in another power play for Team USA upcoming.
Get the PlayStation 4 bundle now. Play NHL 17, the most exciting EA Sports NHL ever on PS4.
Jim, that's a couple straight shifts for just more energy by the Americans, and it ends up with two good scoring chances, and then that foot-on-foot as Ehrhoff knocks Pavelski down. Let's see if they can translate that aggression 5-on-4 now on the power play.
So you feel they need something, they need a goal before the end of this period. And
they've had Halak looking behind himself a couple of times there as there's been lots of traffic on shots in front.
Pavelski, Parisi, and Kane up front. TJ Oshie and John Carlson back. That's the power play that's going to work here. 0-for-1 with a disallowed goal. Pavelski. Zach Parisi. Anto Pavelski to Patrick Kane around the outside. Here's Carlson closing in. One-timer, Pavelski, and Halak got across and got a piece of that. They got the setup they wanted, and Pavelski got the shot. Here's Kane back in again. Pavelski sets up over the left side. A right-handed shot for the one-timer. Kane threads the needle. Pavelski can't control the puck and get the shot. Pavelski again into the middle. Carlson, Kane, his one-timer's blocked by Zdeno Chara. Parisi to Pavelski. Carlson around to Kane. Parisi goes to the net. Oshie's in the middle of the ice in the slot. Chara watching. Oshie with a shot, and he missed the net. Pavelski tracks the puck down to Patrick Kane, closing in with a shot. Chara with the block. Kane's got the puck again. Carlson to his forehand. Kopitar watching both of them as Kane has the puck. Pavelski backs up. He's open over on the left side. Kane again to Pavelski, and again it doesn't work. Tipped on the way through. TJ Oshie. Carlson. Oshie's one-timer. That's blocked by Sekera. Long penalty-killing shift for the four Team Europe players that are on the ice. Been there for a minute 40. Bouncing puck, side of the net. Chara ties up the stick of Parisi. Kopitar back for the puck, and he finally is able to clear it. A minute and 50 seconds trapped in their own zone on a penalty kill.
Yeah, that's a power play that may not score, but it's not a momentum killer. A lot of positive puck movement there by the Americans just missing their shot.
Penalty's over. Here's a chance out of the penalty box. Christian Ehrhoff trying to get a breakaway. And he gets hit and gets the puck. Centering. Hansen to the net. A tip. They score. 3-0 lead for Team Europe. Pierre-Edward Bellemare. After a big U.S. power play failed.
All the pressure that power play had. They had the setup they want. They got the passes they want. A one-timer from Pavelski just goes a little high and wide. At the effort of Halak getting across, getting a little bit of the top of the head off of it. And then a flip pass to Ehrhoff, which he keeps alive. The pressure on, and maybe just for a second, the Americans take a breath. And an odd play, Jim, a heads-up play by Bellemare, just getting his stick in the way, knocking that deflection down as Quick couldn't find it. Two good missed opportunities on the power play, one by Oshie, one by Pavelski. And then a bit of a fluke goal by Bellemare that they're just making sure it wasn't a high stick.
I don't think it was. And now it's a 3-0 game with just a minute and a half left in period number two.
No coach's challenge there as they went over to talk to John Tortorella, but what a momentum swing, that non-goal there by James Van Riemsdyk and off the head of Stepan. And as you said, Jim, survived the penalty kill. A dead tired play by Anze Kopitar that was able to alleviate the pressure, which sets up that goal.
Well, Bellemare of the Philadelphia Flyers and the only representative from France has a goal as the puck is out of play. It was in the midst of a change just as Ehrhoff had stepped back in the ice.
You mentioned earlier the experience of this European team. Watch Kopitar under pressure, doesn't panic, gets the puck protected, keeps it down ice, and he stays to the right side so that Jonathan Quick can't get the puck up the other end. And the end result there is a good change. Fresh bodies come out, and Bellemare puts the puck in the back of the net.
Four of their most experienced players, Anze Kopitar, Marian Hossa, Zdeno Chara, and Andre Sekera, out to kill the penalty for a minute 50 seconds. Trapped in their own zone, but no panic, and they got through it.
That's part of being a veteran, is knowing how to play when you're exhausted. Hardest thing to learn as a youngster in the National Hockey League. It'll be interesting to watch the North American team if something similar like that happens in a game.
Last minute of the second period, a commanding 3-0 lead for Europe. 3 goals on 9 shots. Pacioretty with a long pass off the boards. Dubinsky can't get the puck. It's an icing call against the USA with 37 seconds left in the second period.
Well, and right now, you think of instinctively, you think of John Tortorella and fiery and full of energy and maybe peel some paint off in the room. This is a time where you're 2 periods into this tournament that is such a sprint. You have to be careful of just how hard you go at the guys. I think you have to get some energy back in that USA room and try to regroup and chip away early in the third period.
Thomas Tatar off the faceoff. Anze Kopitar. You'll see a lot of this in the third period. The European team, if they can have their way. I think they've been pretty good defensively in the first two, with a 3-0 lead in the third. They'll clog up the middle. They won't give the Americans anything.
They've protected the puck very well, haven't they? They haven't made too many mistakes in that regard.
Seidenberg off the glass into the attacking zone. Some real intrigue on day one of the World Cup in the first game. Team USA behind 3-0 to Team Europe. Ron?
Hey, Jim, Scott Oaks hoping to talk to Blake Wheeler. We may have to get an 18-wheeler because she's off the cliff right now for the United States. Did they get the shaft in that second period? Kelly Rudy thinks so, but it's not like you think about the disallowed goal. We'll have that. Also, Sean McKenzie talks to Steven Stamkos about the game tonight, the Czechs and the Canadians, and Tara Sloan from the Rogers Fan Hub, all coming up in our second intermission. The newly minted captain of the Winnipeg Jets, Blake Wheeler, is going to speak to Scott Oaks. Scott.
Blake, Team USA was just starting to exert some pressure, and then the goal by Bellmer to put you down 3-0. How would you describe the challenge you face in the third?
You know, we got to get that first one, I think, is the biggest key. Haven't really given up a whole lot, but the ones we've given up have been, pretty big ones. So, you know, we got to find a way to get that first one, try to create some momentum, and, not let the clock run out too fast.
Yeah, clearly, Team Europe is sitting back waiting for Team USA to make mistakes, and they scored two goals on American mistakes. How much of the chatter on the bench has been about the necessity of eliminating odd man rushes?
I mean, that was our game plan coming into the game. You know, be smart at the blue line, eliminate their chances, and, you know, once they got that first one, you could see they really sat back, and we're going to try to make that one count. We just try to do too much a little bit too often, and it's hurt us a little bit.
Thank you, Blake. Appreciate your time.
Anytime.
Anyone here have a problem with a disallowed goal? Puck directed, whether it's straight into the net or off a teammate and in?
No problem. You can understand from a former goalie.
You know, when it slows down, it really does look like Van Riemsdyk tries to direct it. So I could see with video review why a referee would rule that way.
Agreed. John Tortorella would be hot about a couple of other things, Nick.
Well, turnovers, blatant turnovers. And while you can watch the one particularly that Pat Kane was involved with, I sit there and I wonder about who's backing him up. Let's face it, this is what Pat Kane does. His skill and creativity will always be there, and as Joel Quenneville knows, the pros outweigh the cons. But Eric Johnson totally gets caught here. Good on Niederreiter to take away that outlet pass that he was hoping to beat. But this is about backing him up and making sure if in fact he does turn it over, you're there. Craig Simpson talked about the turnover that Ryan McDonagh had. Hey, Ryan, you're trying to beat two guys. You're out of your wheelhouse. But that totally fell into Pat Kane's game. Now it's a matter of being on the same page defensively if you do have that turnover.
Thought it was interesting. I was curious to see how Tortorella was going to react to that Kane giveaway, because he's shown in the NHL if you make a defensive mistake, you can sit. He went hard to Kane after that. He double shifted him a lot, and now he really needs him in the third period. Guys, this is astonishing what's happening so far.
And on occasion, luck plays a part of the outcome. And this afternoon, there's no question, just prior to that giveaway by Kane where they went up 2-0 Team Europe, Kane had this excellent scoring opportunity, and luck played a part in the save by Halak. That hits the top of the shaft of his goalie stick. That he did not see, and, you know, that could have been 1-1. And maybe at that point, if they tie up the game, Team USA plays a little bit looser, they're having a little bit more fun. All of a sudden, they look really, really scared.
We spoke about not dressing Byfuglien, so what? That's second guessing, but you do start to see no Eichel, no Larkin, no Goodrow. The United States, it's always an all-star team, so it takes a while to gel, but boy, they are really in a jam here, Nick.
They really are, and I would hope that by any stretch, they wouldn't think that they're out of this hockey game. They do have enough firepower, but I thought Matt Niskanen, he hit
Zuccarello, and that started a bit of what we've seen in the pre-tournament games with a little bit of physicality. They've got to pick that up where they left off.
I thought Wheeler said it really well. We've got to do something to give us some momentum, some confidence, a feeling that we can accomplish something. I thought that was a great point he made in the interview with Scott.
A couple of things. Just Bufflin in game one of the pre-tournament joining the rush, and then I'm going to show you Connor McDavid defensively, because you said, who's going to cover for Kane? It has to be Johnson. I mean, Suter was trying to help him out, giving him the outlet pass, as you said. But this is Dustin Bufflin, real presence playing defense. They then tried him in game two on the wing, ended up on the fourth line, ended up out of the lineup tonight. So there's a Winnipeg Jet really missing for John Tortorella.
And who does that kind of remind you of? Yossi. That's Absolutely. What he does, right? And so I'm finding the U.S. not allowing too many of the defensemen to add into that rush like that.
First practice for Team North America. I mentioned the hotshot young Americans. Connor McDavid directs traffic. He has been incredible. Gostisbehere was pinching in a game in the pre-tournament. It was McDavid backing him up at the point. There he is with the hand, working on stuff in his own end.
And so much is made out of the fact that he hasn't scored a point in three pre-tournament games, and yet it's the special players that can still stand out when they're not scoring. And we saw that out of Laine in Finland, and we saw that out of Austin Matthews as well. So that's a good sign for these young kids.
Connor McDavid of Newmarket, where the first Rogers hometown hockey will be on the 15th and the 16th of October. We're going to check in with Tara Solnit. Actually, he's down at the Scotiabank Fan Village. Also have Sean McKenzie and Steven Stamkos from just south of Newmarket in Markham, Ontario. Tee up the game between Canada and the Czech Republic this evening, starting with our coverage at 7:30 here at ACC. More of the World Cup in a moment. Everything happens fast nowadays. Back in 87, Canada Cup, Kelly Rudy was on the team. They reported to Montreal August 2nd, didn't play a game till August 28th. Can you imagine? Steve Stamkos has been waiting for a while. He's with Sean McKenzie about tonight.
Steven, it feels like this moment is kind of a long time coming for you. You're so close to making the Olympic team in 2010. Obviously, you had the injury in 2014. Just what does this moment mean to you, especially with this tournament getting going today?
I think a little more to me than others, for sure. Like you mentioned, extremely disappointing not being able to go to Sochi. But it was great to just be part of that experience. And now getting the call to come play here, really excited me. It seems like it's been a month already for this camp and a couple exhibition games. Guys are ready to go. So I think for me, a little more excited than ever.
It looks like you're going to play on a line with John Tavares and Ryan Getzlaf. Ever in your career have you been on a line with that much talent?
I don't think so. That's pretty unique when you're on a team like this. And being able to play with the talent that's out there is kind of a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. So you obviously want to take advantage of it, but that's what makes our team so unique is guys are ready and willing to play with whoever and do whatever it takes to win. That's what, has won in the past.
With all that being said, you're a shooter. So how do you balance that urge to want to shoot but also dish the puck to the guys in your line when they have that much skill?
Babs has already been on me a little bit about trying to overpass. I think that's the tendency when you get to these tournaments is you don't want to be that selfish guy that always shoots the puck, but in reality you're put on a line that best fits the line and the individuals. And obviously with Getzy and JT, they can shoot the puck, but they're elite dishers too, so I got to go out there with the mentality to shoot first and hopefully create some scoring chances.
You start the tournament with the Czech Republic today, but the way this tournament is formatted, is every game important? Is there not that feeling out process, so to speak?
Yeah, there really isn't. And that's obviously unique to this event. Is I know we had the exhibition games, but you get thrown in the fire a little bit into the tournament. It's such a short tournament with the exception of the two out of three in the final. So there's really no room for error. I think that's why the coaching staff's really harped on us to just take one game at a time, and they've prepared us that way.
Thanks, Steven. Good luck tonight.
Thank you.
Okay, Sean, thanks kindly. The Distillery District in Toronto is just a few blocks east of the Air Canada Centre. 40 heritage buildings, cafes, shops. It's fantastic. It's the home of the Fan Village. Last night, the Killers performed. Kelly Rudy, Tara Sloan, and I were there for a wonderful show, and Tara's at the Rogers Fan Hub right now. Tara.
Yeah, Ron, it was such a great night. They tell me about 13,000 people passed through the gates for the kickoff party featuring the Killers. And a lot of people here today, in spite of the rain, and I don't have to tell you, they've done such a great job here at the Fan Village. It's massive. There's lots for the whole family to do. Viewing parties, live music throughout the course of the week. In fact, Theo Fleury and his band rocked out just a little bit earlier today. And right behind me is my home away from home for the duration. This is the Rogers Fan Hub. And this is a place where fans can gather. They can play cool interactive games, experiment with virtual reality, win prizes, or simply hang out and get out of the rain as it is today. So I will be here. But you know what? If you aren't in Toronto, make sure you check out rogers.com/NHL. And you can also take part in some very cool fan experiences. Ron, back to you.
Rogers hometown hockey host Tara Sloan. Thank you, Tara. Don't forget now, goal differential is a big factor come when we decide who makes it through to the semifinals. So USA has got to get on their horse. The third period at the ACC is next.
Saturday, it's going to be a good day. Always is. It's because of all the games during the week. The one played on Saturday night is a special one. This is the story of a love affair between a country and a game. If you want to try and teach someone about Canada, you go to the television Saturday night and it becomes crystal clear. This is Hockey Night.
The World Cup of Hockey, Sunday on Sportsnet. We are Sweden, designed to win. We are Russia, brilliance on ice. Sweden, Russia, Sunday on Sportsnet and Rogers NHL Game Center Live. It's all about winning.
Russell Martin with a home run.
Doing whatever it takes.
The Warriors, tough as nails.
The finish line is near.
Oh, my goodness.
Blue Jays, Angels, tonight on Sportsnet 1 and Sportsnet 360.
World Cup is nicely underway at Air Canada Centre, and tonight Sidney Crosby, Team Canada, begin their quest for the World Cup with a showdown against Thomas Plekanec in the Czech Republic. The Canadian bus arrived here at ACC about an hour ago. Andrej Kopitar is a two-time Stanley Cup champion, but he would count leading Slovenia, a country with less than 200 registered hockey players, into the 2014 Olympics as just as big a thrill. And it was Kopitar to the rescue of his country a few weeks ago in an Olympic qualifying tournament. In the final, Slovenia versus Belarus for a berth in the 2018 Games in Korea. The game went to a shootout where Kopitar broke the tie. Slovenia went on to the win and advanced to the Olympics. Kopitar finished the tournament with 3 goals, 2 assists, and the shootout goal. Whether NHL players go to Pyeongchang remains to be seen, but Slovenia will be there thanks to Kopitar, who at this moment is surely anticipating a Team Europe upset win over the USA in Game 1 of the World Cup, Jim.
7 rinks in Slovenia. Just 7 rinks and one NHL player, and Kopitar proving you only need one rink to win for Team Europe today. They're up 3-0. A wonderful strategic game by a group of nomadic veterans from 8 different countries. France, Germany, and Slovakia have scored goals today. And a 3-0 lead, and a desperate Team USA needs offense right away in this third period. James Van Riemsdyk, whose goal was disallowed because he directed the puck into the net via his chest, is on the ice with TJ Oshie and Joe Pavelski. And a different looking forward line, and here's an offside call early. But Derek Stepan had the puck after it hit Van Riemsdyk go off his head into the net. Here on the bench, I think he's suggesting this is why it should be a good goal. It went off the chest of James and it hit me in the head. That should be a good goal. But actually what he's doing is making a perfect explanation of why it isn't. Because you cannot direct the puck with any part of your body towards the net. And even if it hits someone, it's no goal.
No, and just the tough part of that one is the distinction that it was a chest knock in. I thought so often if he's just going in, doesn't make any motion at all, and it just hits off him and in, it would be a goal. So another tough break. And a great opportunity here for Europe to get their first win.
Sparks the debate, though, about whether that should be a good goal in a goal-starved league.
Absolutely. I personally think that should be a goal.
Here's Matt Zuccarello with a shot. Jonathan Quick with a save. Another 3-on-2 for opportunistic Team Europe.
They just keep coming, don't they? There's so many odd man rushes, and what a frustrating game for Jonathan Quick having to deal with it. At the other end, Jaro Halak has been able to hold the fort when he's had to. 19 shots now by the Americans, and Halak, as advertised, needed to be good. I think his team in front of him has been excellent, but Halak has done his job as well.
Hasn't been a barrage of shots, though. That's only 19 for Team USA. Max Pacioretty, Blake Wheeler, and Ryan Kessler together. The lines have been juggled. Up late comes Eric Johnson. Lost control of the puck. Mark Sprite got it back. Kessler's trying to take it back for Team USA. Belmar and Vanek. Mark Sprite up the boards. Jack Johnson pinched, couldn't get the puck. And back is Montreal captain Max Pacioretty. Straight up the middle. Fires a shot. Halak makes the save. As he's been wont to do at any time when there's a little pressure in this game, stop the play.
Yeah, I think they're really confident in just slowing the game down. When you've got that cushion of the three goals, don't make any risky plays. Goaltender, stop it, have some faith. Even though in the faceoff dot, the Americans have the advantage, that three-goal cushion now just better safe than sorry.
Europe won the draw, but the sharp-angled shot from the corner is stopped by Halak. Abdelkader got the shot.
Well, here's the intriguing part for John Tortorella now. You have to start taking some risks, but risks have been the problem for his team, and they've been aggressive. They've been giving up far too much. It'll see how risky they do get here, though, down by three, Jim.
Americans got the draw. Niskanen got the shot. That came hard off a body in front of the net. Europe got it back. Sekera and Chara, their experienced defensive pair, hit the puck ahead and down the ice. Leon Draisaitl scored on a 2-on-0 from Niederreiter in the second period. Backus, Abdelkader, and Dubinsky. That's one line that stayed the same. They're in the forecheck. Sekera, all the forwards back. There's a USA penalty coming up here as Reeder dumps the puck in. Suter's back for it, and Team Europe with a 3-0 lead is going to the power play. It's a high sticking call.
And that look says it all. Dubinsky coming in on the big body of Chara. Chara just holds him up, and it's the after play there. As he falls down, the stick goes in the bridge of the nose of Chara. 200 feet from your own net, and you give the Europeans another 2 minutes of solace. And that's something John Tortorella is not too happy about.
It's a 4-minute penalty. So obviously there was a little damage as they went over and checked on Zdeno Chara, and this is a 4-minute, a double minor to Brandon Dubinsky, and you can see why.
Right across the bridge of the nose.
There's Marian Hossa. Anze Kopitar. Thomas Tatar's in front of the net. Roman Josef is a +3 in the game, is back on the blue line. Thomas Vanek on the power play, shorthanded. Derek Stepan with Wheeler. And Ryan McDonough had a big collision there, and down goes Kopitar, and down went Wheeler, and they're both okay. Swiss defenseman Josef bumps the puck in. Overload the right side. Carlson got a hold of the puck and put it by the ear of Vanek all the way down the ice. Power play starts to change. Abdelkader and Kessler shorthanded. They'll have to take some chances here shorthanded as Abdelkader fires a shot that's blocked. Kopitar got the puck to center. Franz Nielsen takes over. The drop pass. Kaverick's shot is blocked. Kessler races after the puck, got to it and just shoots it in, and he'll head to the bench as the penalty killers change up. Mark Streit is back. Gabrick, Niederreiter, Zuccarello up front. Nielsen weaves in, shoots, and he just missed. Nice move with the blue line for Franz Nielsen, who's had a strong game. Mark Streit starts the breakup, and he'll have to start it again.
Yeah, for those of you who haven't seen much of Franz Nielsen, you're getting it front and center, aren't you? He's made some fantastic plays in the neutral zone, showed good speed and a couple of wonderful passes.
Been a good player for a while. Franz Nielsen from Denmark, now up the Detroit Red Wings. Kopitar's back out of the power play. Ralph Kruger with a quick shift to the second power play unit gets the big boys back out there trying to seal this.
Yeah, last two power plays for Europe, it's kind of taken away all the momentum they're gaining 5-on-5. It's been a bit of a lull, but with this 4-minute power play, that's time that's real valuable for Europe.
Ryan McDonough double team, now triple teamed in the corner. Marian Hossa protects the puck. Plays it back, Kopitar. Roman Josi Round the outside, into the middle. Vanek's pass wasn't tipped. Kopitar. Thomas Tatar. Here's Josi, fires his shot. That hit Carlson in the hand, and that hurt. Europe gets the puck back. Josi again with a shot off the stick. Here's a chance for Thomas Vanek. His pass. McDonough intercepted, but then he couldn't control the puck. What a save by Quick there off Tatar. Josi. Kopitar. Thomas Tatar. And the puck comes out over the blue line. Josi is there in the last minute of the four-minute penalty to Brandon Dubinsky.
Well, if the Americans are able to come back in this game, you got to go back to that save there. It was a wide-open net, and somehow Jonathan Quick, leaning forward, was able to get his glove up and make the save.
After it looked like McDonough had the puck and could get it out, he made a good play. Penalty killers move out to center again. Kane comes onto the ice. Kessler. Gotta keep Kane in the game because he's the best hope to score, so he's out shorthanded. Late in the penalty. Here's Zuccarello. Two on one. Delays. Nielsen's in front, and he's stopped by Jonathan Quick. Zuccarello again. Mark Streit. Hans Nielsen to Streit. Has Ehrhoff on the other side. Gabrick. Front of the net. Here's a pass to Franz Nielsen to strike his shot. Knocked down was Quick by Gabrick, and the puck stayed out of the net. Penalty's over. Dubinsky's back on. A hard centering pass taken away by the Americans, and now they start up. Brandon Dubinsky out of the penalty box with a drop pass and hopped over the stick of Patrick Kane. He battled to get the puck back. Threw it into the middle of the ice. Jack Johnson turns to his forehand. Centering pass. Bouncing puck. Look at all the blue sweaters back in front of the net. And that's happened all through this afternoon game. Very good defensive effort for Team Europe. And even though they didn't score on the power play, they kept America away from their net for 4 minutes. Andrei Sekera. Checked by T.J. Oshie, who's trying to protect the puck. There's Eric Johnson. His pass is deflected by Pavelski, who bangs his stick on the ice because he missed. Jack Johnson to Eric Johnson. Johnson and Johnson move up the ice. Abdelkader. T.J. Oshie delays his shot. Went off a skater's pass. Oshie again with a slap shot. Halak on the rebound. Stop. Abdelkader right in front of the net. Kessler slashes away trying to keep that puck in. And couldn't do it. Brian Kessler could have had another penalty.
And there's one of the rare chances, Jim, where you saw a second opportunity. There haven't been enough of those for the United States. It's been one and done, and Halak able to make both.
Andre Kopitar sliding was McDonough to block the pass for Hossa. Marian Hossa again can't control the puck in front. Max Pacioretty through the middle of the ice. Parisi heads for the front of the net. Pacioretty back for Carlson. That was intercepted by Thomas Tatar. And he slaps the puck out to center ice.
Well, that had a chance of going over the boards. That would have been a penalty for Europe. So another break. That one stayed in.
Here's Derek Stepan. From the blue line, Niskanen just held the puck in. Ryan Suter bounces it off the boards. Seidenberg muted the check of Pacioretty and got the puck to center ice. And the Europeans change again. America does as well. Icing call against Team USA.
The fifth season is when kids dream big. That's why we're a proud sponsor of the World Cup of Hockey, with over 8,000 community teams across Canada.
Down by three. There's no room for any mistake by Jonathan Quick. There's the mistake in front of him, but an extra effort. Diving. Just make sure he gets his arm up. Hit right in the crook of his elbow there as that one had a chance as Tatar in alone. Couldn't get it up and over the goaltender.
There's another play where Ryan McDonough looked like he'd broken it up. He's had a tough afternoon. Van Riemsdyk, Kane, and Stepan are back together again. Kane can't control the puck. He's smothered by Zuccarello. Gabrick couldn't get the puck out. Stepan kept it in. Christian Ehrhoff. He too is an unrestricted free agent looking for a job. What a place to audition. Backhander went off Jack Johnson to center.
Jim, both he and Dennis Seidenberg have played very well here, and a lot of focus on them, as you mentioned, free agent.
There have been no passengers on Team Europe, and
all.
We wondered how they could come together as a team or how well they would, but they certainly have.
I thought their back end might be a bit of a weakness here and something the USA could maybe take advantage of, but to this point, this hasn't materialized at all.
The Europeans have stalled the speed game of the United States. Haven't let them play the game fast. There's another turnover in the neutral zone favoring Team Europe. Thomas Vanek fires a shot, quick to save. Belmar quick to the rebound. He got there first ahead of Backus. Kubinski can't handle the bouncing puck. Chara back for it. Andre Sekera up the boards to center. Vanek was on a change. He didn't want to touch the puck. And it goes for an icing call. And Vanek was concerned it might be too many men on the ice, so he let it go for icing instead.
Well, Jim, I think this matchup for the United States is one that just didn't have any emotion from the beginning. You think of the start of this tournament. This is a preseason game, number one, USA against Canada on U.S. soil. And it was Ryan Kessler who really started the emotion. And you wonder to start this game. It just never had this kind of energy. The Americans didn't have the jump. They didn't have the emotion. And they all played right into the game of the Europeans. And they just have not been able to get on track.
Pavelski won the draw. Suter couldn't get his shot through to the net. B.J. Oshie attacking the puck. Pavelski with him and James Van Riemsdyk. And again, the Europeans get a hold of the puck and chip it down the ice, and there'll be another icing call. And we've passed the halfway mark of period number three with Europe leading 3-0. Blue Jays are out on the West Coast, and all is well in Toronto right now because they've won two in a row. Francisco Liriano goes tonight against Ricky Nolasco, a 9:05 start, 8:30 on Sportsnet. Team Canada playing tonight at the World Cup of Hockey. And we'll have that for you as they play the Czech Republic. And if the coaches want to send a message to the team about never taking any team lightly, they just have to refer to this game. Bouncing puck to the net. I'm not so sure that America took this European team lightly. They just don't have a rivalry against them, and the Europeans have played a very sound defensive game. They've scored 3 goals on 16 shots, an upset in the making in game one of the World Cup of Hockey. Canada still to come, but USA in trouble. Gabrick, Belmar, Draisaitl have scored. Didn't I tell you last night, Team Europe should be a favorite?
In the pool? Yeah,
not a chance. But what's happened to Team USA here?
Well, I think the way that it happened early on, where they were a real aggressive team, right from the beginning, they tried to get on Europe and turn pucks over, and it created the odd man rushes. 5 of them early on, 2 of them end up in the back of the net, and I think that gets your foot on the brake when you're really trying to get it back on the gas pedal. And the USA hasn't been able to recover at this point.
A very good performance by everyone on Team Europe, but particularly the Kopitar line that's on the ice right now. Here's Tatar. Anze Kopitar snaps a shot, and he just missed as he took a shot at his LA King teammate. Marian Hossa retrieves the puck. Left it for Kopitar. Kessler intercepted, and the Americans turn up ice. Kessler, Parisi, and Kane are together now. Patrick Kane to the net. Jaro Halak makes the save on the 25th shot on goal and smothers it.
And there's another example of a nice, neat, and tidy play at the net by Jaro Halak, not allowing a rebound. And, Jim, I think when you're not getting those open shots, then you have to start creating things from getting it from the side. And that's what Patrick Kane, instead of trying to dipsy-doodle and find a way through, tries to get it to the front where he's got Parise, and instead Halak, a heads-up play, able to hold on.
Zuccarello couldn't get the puck up. Held into the side of the net. Here's Dubinsky. Noisy board battle, and Blake Wheeler steps in. Abdelkader's there as well. All the lines have been juggled. as John Tortorella tries to find some offense. This line's had a wonderful day, but Nielsen couldn't get the puck out. Wheeler with a shot. There's Jaro Halak again. Sometimes he has injury problems. Can't sustain great play through the entire season, but he does have an upset pedigree.
Absolutely.
And he can get streaky.
He's done it at the NHL level. He's done it internationally. And there was another great example, Jim, of just the structure of the European team. Good defensive positioning and battling along the boards. When there was a breakdown, there's one shot. Everybody else was boxed out. The goaltender was able to see it. This has been a pretty solid clinic here by the European team.
Pavelski, Oshie. James Van Riemsdyk take a turn. We've seen much of Zach Parise on these top lines lately. John Carlson's back for the puck. The Europeans just back off. All of them skating backwards in the neutral zone right now. Oshie races in after the puck. He's got Van Riemsdyk up front. Puck hit the side of the net, and the Europeans get it back. And a lucky bounce for Team Europe to get the puck to center, and they'll change again. Now they're just working the clock. Dennis Seidenberg back for the puck. He and Halak with a little miscommunication. They didn't pay for it. Roman Josi, Marian Hossa with Tatar, Thomas Tatar, deeks, and he can't finish it off. And that would have finished off Team USA if they're not done already. Up the middle, Kessler barges through, a weak shot, rebound for Kane, can't bury it. Tatar sprawled to help out Halak. And there's a penalty coming up, an interference call against Team Europe. And the Americans will get another power play to try and score on Jaro Halak. There's the battle at the side of the net. Parise got held up and taken down. Mark Streit is going to go. Team USA expected big things still here in this tournament. But well, the faces on the American team tell you of their frustration today.
Yeah, despondent, frustrated at times, on looking, can't believe what's happened. And that's in a tournament that happens so quickly. The time flies, and this game seems to have just been slipping away from their grasp. This is a really important power play chance here.
Christian Ehrhoff went off, not Mark Streit. An interference call. Here's TJ Oshie. John Carlson fires a shot. Halak to save. There's a rebound. It's up for grabs, and Halak is down with lots of help.
There's some hacking and whacking going on. That desperation you want. Parise, who is the one, Jim, as you mentioned, drew the penalty to give the United States this chance, and a good effort there of getting traffic in front. Halak feeling like he got hacked a few times, and why not? You've got to make sure that he can't see the puck. Look at all the bodies through. Parise with one chance. A second one came there as Kane came down, and that's the reaction that Halak had. Good positioning by Parise, but he's unable to find that loose puck in the battle. And there's a hack that Halak gives back and then gets it for Parise.
This is a Jaro Halak who's reminiscent of 2010 when he took the Montreal Canadiens on that fabulous run that had people thinking that Carey Price is the guy that should go in Montreal and Halak should stay.
And Jim, isn't that the magic of this tournament too? The one game that can make such a difference. At most here, you're only going to be playing six. So find a way to get through.
And the Americans are facing a situation where Tuesday against Canada could be a must-win game.
Absolutely.
Patrick Kane as the power play continues. John Carlson into the middle, passes off. Kane has the puck. Pavelski trying to find some open space in the slot. Side of the net. Parise bats away at the puck. And the rebound came off to Pierre-Edouard Bellemare, and he cleared the puck down the ice.
Isn't that a bit of the story of the night? The rebounds have been there a few times, but there's been far too many blue sweaters there before the white ones can get to.
Oshie moves in again and drops the puck off to Carlson. On the other side, here's Kane. Snaps a shot, missed the net. Carlson again. Parise parks in front of the net. Oshie's in the slot. Kane now on the right side. Double team. Team Europe gets the puck, couldn't get it out. Carlson kept it in. Now Pavelski to the front of the net. Oshie couldn't tip that. Patrick Kane again. Carlson's one-timer knocked down by Hideyoshi. Pavelski on the rebound. Halak is down, and he's got the puck with 36 seconds remaining in the penalty to Ehrhoff.
Well, it's the best pressure that the Americans have had. You mentioned the Belmar goal came after other good pressure, but this one is pressure at the net. You could see everybody collapsing to the front. The rebound was there. Pavelski gets two whacks at it. And you think as a referee, you got your eyes on so many different things. Here's the look from Kelly Sutherland, getting the point from Carlson on the point, explaining to him exactly what should be going on, and Carlson making sure that he doesn't go in, so the faceoff comes outside. That's a great heads-up play and takes you into the life of an NHL official.
Kessler, Van Riemsdyk, Stepan up front of the power play now. Pacioretty lined up at the blue line. Ryan Suter is there, and the pass to Suter. He has to go fetch it. Stepan. Van Riemsdyk high in the slot. Pacioretty, one-timer. Nice save by Halak. Stepan again. Suter. Pacioretty, one-timer. Halak made the save. Got across quickly with a good read, and the rebound is once again cleared.
A little help from your friends, and Halak's had an awful lot of it from his teammates. Two good saves by him, but great support in front of the net.
That's now 34 shots on goal for the Americans to 16 for Team Europe, and it's a 3-0 European lead. Ehrhoff's back on the ice, and the U.S. power play is 0-3. Van Riemsdyk's pass picked off in the neutral zone. Marian Gaborik, who opened the scoring in the first period, on a line with Zuccarello and Nielsen, working the clock in the third period. Jonathan Quick is headed for the bench with 4.5 minutes to go in the third period. And there's a penalty being called on the play. It's going to be against Europe once again. A hooking call that will give the Americans yet another power play as Marian Gaborik goes off. Jaro Halak has been brilliant. Team Europe's ahead, but they're not out of the woods yet at the World Cup. Second consecutive, fourth power play of the day for Team USA as Gaborik goes off.
Well, there hasn't been much that Ralph Kruger could complain about with this team, but there's a bad penalty at the latter part of the third, right into the wheelhouse of Kelly Sutherland as he just gets the stick in there, creates the turnover, you see the point. And a last-ditch effort here by the Americans to try to make this a game. 4:31 to go, and never a bigger power play than this one.
Pretty quiet day for Patrick Kane. He's out on this power play with Pavelski and Parisi. John Carlson and TJ Oshie. And Quick, of course, is back in the net. He'd been pulled with 4.5 minutes to go just as the penalty was about to be called.
Yeah, the second guessers will be talking again, too, about 19 goals and Dustin Byfuglien and a big shot on the blue line as the Americans have not been able to get anything going on their power play.
TJ Oshie. Pavelski sets up for the one-timer. Kane takes a shot. Couldn't thread the needle. Carlson. Patrick Kane. Carlson. Pavelski. Big crowd in front. Pavelski shot. Halak with a wonderful save, and the rebound is cleared once again.
Good positional save by Halak and great response by Chara to just get jumping on that loose puck and clear it down the ice.
Slowly, Derek Stepan. James Van Riemsdyk to Pacioretty to shoot in. Dennis Seidenberg. Off the glass and out. Down to 40 seconds to go in the penalty to Marian Gaborik.
You wonder if Jonathan Quick makes his way now. 3 minutes to go. You need something. I wouldn't be surprised if the net gets empty.
At least as soon as the penalty has expired. In comes Pacioretty. Fires a shot and he missed the net from an angle. And that sends the Americans back once more. Some terrific penalty kills for Team Europe here today, largely led by Hossa, Kopitar, Chara, and Sekera. The latter two still on the ice. 8 seconds to go as the puck's deflected out of play.
And that, what you mentioned early, Jim, you rely on your veteran guys, and you end up with the team that's pressing, that needs to score, can't find a way. There's the response quickly by Chara. Back on the net, gets inside of Parise. Goaltender does his job, defenseman does his as well.
5 seconds left in the penalty as the puck's fired down on Jonathan Quick. Gaborik's back on. U.S. has had a 17-6 shot advantage in the third period. They can't pull Quick now, although it didn't look like they were going to with 2:26 left because there's an icing call. This is the first game of the World Cup. Six straight days of two games a day. The other two teams in Group A play tonight. It's Team Canada against the Czech Republic. We'll start at 7:30 faceoff at 8 Eastern on Sportsnet. Brandon Dubinsky won the draw. Ryan McDonough with a great pass up the middle. Blake Wheeler with a not so great pass, but he got lucky and got the puck back. His shot missed the net. McDonough. There's Wheeler. Dubinsky went to the front of the net. Abdelkader is there as well. McDonough in deep. 2 minutes to go. Quick planted, still in the net. Abdelkader with a shot that's blocked. Abdelkader again with another shot and a nice save by Halak. Dubinsky across to Abdelkader off his stick and just wide of the net. Ryan McDonough lobs one towards the goal. Deflected away. Abdelkader's check. In comes Wheeler. Dubinsky was in front all alone. Abdelkader couldn't get in the puck. Good possession here, but mostly on the outside for Team USA. And the clock continues to tick, favoring Team Europe. Abdelkader in with a hit on Seidenberg. Dubinsky just offside. And a minute and 10 seconds to go, and Jonathan Quick made no move towards the bench.
No, and I think the goal differential issue is probably the reason, because desperation-wise, if this was an elimination game, you got to go for it. And right now, it's clear Halak is dialed in. He's finding the puck through traffic. He's getting support from his D. And my guess, Jim, is that's the lone reason why John Tortorella has kept Quick in there.
If we're going down,
we don't want to lose by 2 or 5.
To the last minute of the first game of the 2016 World Cup. Ryan Suter to TJ Oshie. Chara is back. Eric Johnson, the defenseman, forechecker. There's another odd man rush, a 3-on-2. Ryan Suter's back with a forward back as well, and Team Europe goes offside. 36 seconds remain.
Well, you've got to be shaking your head if you're John Tortorella and your staff. You come in with great hopes, great thoughts of good things to happen, and so much of the talk of going back to 1996 with the big U.S. win. And you think of best on best. Now, this is 3 potential shutouts in a row. A 1-0 loss in Sochi to Canada, a 5-0 loss to Finland, and here seconds away from a 3-0 loss to Europe.
That's Zuccarello with Nielsen and Gabrick. They've been the best line in the game today, and they're trying to finish this off. Gabrick lost control of the neutral zone. Derek Stepan shoots the puck back in. Halak out to meet the puck. Niskanen held the puck into the shot. Stepan trying to break this shutout bid for Halak. Can't do it. And that should be it. Zuccarello lifts the puck in the air. And Team Europe, with an upset victory in Game 1 of the World Cup, a 35-save shutout for Yaroslav Halak, and a 3-0 win for Team Europe in its first ever game. Time for the play of the game, brought to you by Advil.
Well, the speed of Team Europe gave the United States headaches right from the get-go. A couple of bad pinches, a 2-on-1. Speed through the neutral zone again, made it happen. And it's Team Europe that really surprises USA. They played a solid game plan, and those are your Advil plays of the game.
Now a look at the 3 stars, brought to you by Molson Canadian. Jaro Halak with a 35-save shutout. Franz Nielsen, the newest member of the Detroit Red Wings, with a solid game. And Andrzej Kopitar was a tower of strength, especially on the penalty kill. 3-0 Team Europe over Team USA. Canada still to come today. Here's Ron McLean.
All right, Jim and Craig, tonight, 7:30 Eastern, it's the return of Don Cherry and the jacket he's chosen for show one. And in other news, the Czech Republic plays Canada here in the World Cup of Hockey. Don's really wired. In fact, he'll be watching the Jays. It'd be my job to keep him off the Angels. And the Blue Jays are tied with Baltimore, 2.5 back of Bo Sox. They both share the wild card, the Orioles and the Jays. Time for Tim and Sid. Time for Tim and Sid. McAuliffe and Sixero are here all through the World Cup to bridge us between the matinee and the evening game. And the conversation continues on Facebook, facebook.com/sportsnet. Not a lot of big hits in the game today, but the media's got to meet with John Tortorella. So there's hope for Advil to get lots of use. We'll see you in an hour and 20 minutes.